Today we remember all those who have suffered through that dreadful and terrible experience of 9/11, and I'm sure to a person we can all remember where we were on that fateful day. I imagine many of you were at Mass. I bet a good number of you were at Mass. I know I was at Mass, and someone came in and said a small plane hit one of the towers in New York. That sounded very bad. Of course, when we went back to the rectory and saw more, it was far, far more involved than that. In our gospel, the Lord calls from among a vast number of people 12 choice. And as we know the scripture well and hear the gospel so often, the 12 people he chose were not that impressive. But for some reason, out of the vast assembly of people, he had a large number of disciples. But from the disciples, he chose 12 particular people. When we die and we see the Lord face to face, we will have some idea as to why he would select those particular ones. So in this 9/11, a few words about Father Michael Judge, who died at the Trade Center. And again, like the disciples, like the apostles, the Lord has called us. For any special talent? I doubt it. Such is his love, though. He wants us to enter into his work. He has called you. He's called me. On the bright fall morning of September 11, 2001, firefighters across New York were summoned to a scene of unimaginable horror. Two hijacked airliners had crashed in the Twin Towers of the World Trade Center. As firefighters rushed into the burning buildings, they were accompanied by their chaplain, Father Michael Judge. Hundreds of them would die that day among more than 2,000 fatalities in New York, Washington, and Pennsylvania. Father Judge would be among them. In the days that followed, the story of his life and his sacrifice would become known around the world, how he had joined the Franciscans at the age of 15, how he had acquired a wide reputation for his ministry among the poor and homeless, alcoholics, victims of AIDS, and his outreach to the gay community and others alienated or marginalized in the church. There were stories about his own struggles with alcohol and his recovery with the help of Alcoholics Anonymous, and the stories of his love for the firefighters, his courage in joining them in the front lines, his support in coping with stress and sorrow. There seemed to be a special meaning in the fact that Father Michael was listed as the first certified casualty of 9/11. A photograph of his fellow firemen carrying his body from the wreckage to a neighboring church became an icon of that day, an image of loving service and sacrifice, a hopeful answer to messages born of fear and fanaticism. One does not know when we are called what the Lord expects of us, really. And only with his grace can we accomplish anything. I'm sure this Father Michael Judge, too, he had no idea what he was getting into. But again, out of love, when we say yes to God, it's amazing what we can do. I was trying to reflect on the past few days, what makes our country so great? There's a lot of things that makes us great. One of the things is our generosity. We are an exceptionally generous people. I think we realize we're not the most prosperous now, but we could be the most generous. And what always astounded me, again, I'm a different generation than others, but those who served during World War II, and those who lost loved ones in Germany, Japan, even Italy, you know, just a student of history, I'm sort of astounded at how thoughtful Americans are in sort of their forgiveness. I mean, it seemed like, you know, we were no sooner fighting an enemy who really was trying to take over all of Europe, and then we had the Marshall Plan, and we're feeding our enemies and bringing their country to great prosperity. And maybe that's a sign of a great nation. Not to like drag the people after 100 years. We're not going to sow their fields in salt so they cannot eat. But we really do. It's amazing how forgiving we are. And it shows the sort of the depth of who we are and really how great the country is. I think I've shared with you a friend of mine who I care for very much. I thought he was going to be a priest, but he got married as I caught the eye of a very pretty woman. He had said to me a couple years later, he said, very frankly, because we're very good friends, how often do you think a couple should have intercourse? And I made my comments, and I said, well, how frequently do you have intercourse? And he said, once a month. And I thought, wow. And you didn't want to become a priest because you thought you couldn't be celibate, you know? Well, you're on your way, brother. So, but again, I suggested maybe go to a doctor and maybe you two go, you know, just kind of talk it through. Till he comes home and finds his beloved with somebody else. And he finds out it's been happening a few times. Whew. Wow. So they make their way to Sanford, and almost like the woman caught in adultery, kind of not physically, but just kind of thrown into the living room. Now you deal with her. As if, you know, I'm gonna really just, you evil, evil, evil. And I remember so vividly feeling so bad for her. Isn't that strange? She wasn't really the friend, I mean, friend of a friend, but I felt so bad for her. I don't know why, something just came over me. I just felt so, so sad. So I, you know, sometimes just a lot of talk is, it may be a lot of jabber, but sometimes it's helpful. So then my buddy and I went for a walk around the church. So what does God expect of me? What does he want? Robert, you know what God wants. And I was scared, by the way. You know what God wants. I don't have to tell you. And he started crying. I said, my dear brother, no one can hurt me like you've been hurt. No one. I mean, I don't think it's possible for me ever to be hurt. I'll be hurt, but not at the depth that you've been hurt. And if you leave her, if you divorce her, no one will fault you. In fact, many will say, way to go. She got what was coming to her. And no one would fault you. Even heaven itself wouldn't question you. But my brother, you have an opportunity for a tremendous amount of grace. Tremendous. And someday there'll be an old, old woman, you'll be long dead, who will say of you, to say to you, her great-grandchildren, your great-grandpa is a remarkable man. He's a saint. And see, we have opportunities in our life that don't come too often like that, but on obviously rare, rare occasion, we have an opportunity for God's grace. And no one would fault us for getting revenge, being angry, whatever we have to do to react. No one, even God, I think himself, would fault us. But see, our destiny is that of heaven. Our destiny is that of divine. And if we are to be like Christ, then we should start now. And that is so hard. And even myself, walking with that man, I thought to myself, I doubted myself. I said, is it even possible? Is it in human people to be able to forgive like that? And he forgave her. And they have 4 more children. And I look at those children, and I just shake my head quietly, like, wow, how beautiful. If there are any children that are beautiful, these 4 younger ones are the most beautiful. And so he and I and our buddies, we play cards, have a beer, they smoke their cigars. And I just look next to me at him, and I think to myself, so this is what heaven looks like. This is what saints look like. They don't even know it. They'd be embarrassed if you said something. They'd tell you all their sinfulness. I know how it is. They're that way. But we get a glimmer of people like that. And even in our experience of 9/11, oh my gosh, tremendous, tremendous suffering and pain. But we have an opportunity. We still have an opportunity for God's abundant grace. We don't have to ask for it. Maybe some don't need it. I do. But that's what makes us saints. Those moments when we have been so devastated and so hurt, and God doesn't judge us. We can react the way one side of us pushes us to. And yet there's the other side, that divine side, that baptized side, that side full of God's grace. And then we weep and cry. I can't do this alone. God says, no, you can't. I'm here to help you. I'm here to give you strength. Let us stand and pray.